OK, we will resume business, and the next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 12842 in the name of Tess White on new energy infrastructure in the north of Scotland. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I invite Tess White to begin the debate around 7 minutes, Ms White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have secured the parliamentary time to raise plans for massive transmission infrastructure in the north of Scotland. Thank you to all the members who supported today's motion. The proposals in question put forward by SSEN Transmission include a new 400 kV pylon route from Kintore to Teeling in the northeast, as well as two new substations. If plans are allowed to go ahead, this towering and sprawling infrastructure will puncture our countryside and industrialise our rural communities. Seen as the breadbasket of Scotland, it will affect our hugely productive farmland in the northeast, which boasts malting barley, soft fruit, bulbs and field vegetables. It will impact the local economy, and there are concerns not just about the financial implications, but the implications for community wellbeing too. I would like to say the gallery is full of representatives, but they're coming in now. So we have representatives in the gallery from the affected communities, and I thank them for coming today. They've travelled from Angus and Aberdeenshire to protest outside the Scottish Parliament because they feel utterly disillusioned and disenfranchised about this process. Presiding Officer, we're told this new infrastructure is needed for the connection of ScotWind offshore wind projects in the North Sea. The Scottish Government has exclusive discretion to approve and deny applications for offshore wind in Scotland and Scottish waters. There is already too much energy being licensed into the grid, far too few connections, and an insufficient transfer mechanism, and yet the first ScotWind leasing round allocated more offshore wind than anyone expected. In other words, the SNP government sold it cheap, and they sold off much more than they needed. Little thought was given by the SNP government to the transmission network and the infrastructure required to land the power from these projects in the north of Scotland. And it's no wonder the Climate Change Committee concluded that the Scottish Government has failed to bring the Scottish people and the Scottish Parliament a climate change plan that is fit for purpose. Presiding Officer, all of us are keenly aware of the challenge facing Scotland and the UK as we continue down the road to net zero. We know that we need to decarbonise our electricity system, but many of the people who will live and work in the shadow of those monster pylons or next to the whopping substations do not feel as if they are being helped along that road. For them, this is an unjust transition. To reach net zero, we need to see joined-up thinking between the Scottish Government and transmission operators such as SSEN, as well as close working with local stakeholders. We need to see careful, consistent and considered engagement with affected communities, but that simply hasn't been the case.
Will Tess White give way?
Yes. I'll take
Douglas one. Ross.
I'm grateful to Tess White for giving way, and can I reiterate her praise to the campaigners who have come to our Parliament today protesting outside, but to see such significant numbers for a member's debate. But Tess White was discussing the consultation and listening to these communities. I've been contacted by many in Moray, in particular farmers in Moray, who are concerned about the proposals to put large pylons through good agricultural land. Does Tess White believe, as I do, that much more needs to be done to listen to the concerns of our farmers and our communities who are raising really serious issues about these proposals?
Tess White.
Thank you. Yes, we need to listen to the farmers. This is productive land that once gone, it cannot come back. And food security is just as important as energy security. My background is energy. Yes?
Marie Guichon.
I'm just touching on the important point that the member had made about that engagement with communities, and I'm sure, like me, she shared that shock, that real anger, when the proposals for the new overhead line seemed to appear out of nowhere at the start of last year, as they hadn't featured in any of the project plans that had been published up until that point, where there had only been talk about line upgrades rather than a new line. And that's where I would also ask the member if she would agree with me that meaningful consultation by the authorities who are responsible for these decisions should have been done before we're anywhere near a planning application, and that proper, full, transparent consultation needs to be undertaken by National Grid ESO when they're taking such important decisions that have such massive ramifications for our constituents as well as wider rural Scotland.
Tess White, and I can give you the time back for both interventions.
Thank you for that intervention. And I'm glad to see that Marie Guichon raised that question, because she is a minister in the Scottish Government. And as I said in First Minister's questions, the Scottish Government needs to use its devolved powers. And it cannot, like the Energy Minister, wash her hands of the consultation and wash her hands of this process. My background is energy. I come from the energy sector. I know the importance of proper consultation, and SSEN's consultation has fallen woefully short of an appropriate standard. They have totally and utterly dropped the ball. The anxiety and stress that it has caused my constituents is simply unacceptable. Yesterday, SSEN did commit to consider community and landowner proposed alignments and confirmed it has delayed the overhead line alignment consultation. But I'd just like to say it's such a shame that it has taken a very visible demo from community groups to push SSEN into landowner and community consultation. And affected residents know that once SSEN have made their choices, the final decision won't rest with local councils. The buck, as I've said, will stop with the Scottish Government's Energy Consent Unit, and that's what terrifies them. It really terrifies them, because many communities have already gone through the trauma of being steamrolled over with industrial-side wind farms on their doorsteps. And that's bad enough. But last year, SNP MP Alan Brown even tried to remove the right for local planning authorities to have a public inquiry into situations like this, and this is not lost on the local communities. It was averted thanks to Andrew Bowie, the Scottish Conservative MP for West Aberdeenshire and Kincardine. He stopped it in its tracks, and we will fight to retain the right to public local inquiry where the developer and community are not able to come to terms. Presiding officer, just last week, the Minister for Energy, Just Transition and Fair Work washed her hands of the whole thing. She said it was up to the transmission operators to bring the affected communities with them. That will be hard for her constituents in Turriff and New Deer to hear. The reality is that this is the wrong kit in the wrong location. It's perfectly possible to put infrastructure underground or offshore, and that does need to be an option. In closing, presiding officer, I support the communities behind Save Our Mearns, Angus Pylon Action Group and Decide Against Pylons in their petition to change this SNP government's approach to what will be a generational change in our landscape. Thank you.
Well, Thank you, Ms. White. Can I advise those in the gallery, it is very good to see you here in such large numbers. This is a meeting taking place in public. It is not, though, a public meeting, and therefore we do not permit participation, and that includes applause. With this, I now open the debate, or we move to the open debate. I call first Fergus Ewing to be followed by Tim Eagle, around 4 minutes. Mr. Ewing.
Tess White is to be congratulated on bringing forward such an important topic for debate today. I start off by saying that I have a great deal of respect for the Minister, who is extremely intelligent and diligent. I would gently suggest that this really should have been a government debate. We really do need to spend... If my opponents could stop applauding me, that would be less embarrassing. But, I mean, I'm also deadly serious about this, because Tess White's motion, it covers a huge range of complex but absolutely essential matters for the future of Scotland. Now, I was Energy Minister for 5 years. It was a privilege. And I was a staunch and remain a staunch supporter of renewables. And I granted many, many consents for offshore and onshore wind farms. That was, I think, the right thing to do. Five judicial reviews were raised against the Scottish Government, and we won every single one. In fact, we managed to beat two particular litigants. One was a famous North East businessman, now a presidential candidate from the United States, and the other was the RSPB, and we won both. I don't know from which victory I derive the greater satisfaction, actually. It's a toss-up. But in all seriousness, Presiding Officer, I want to make a couple of points, really, because there isn't time in this short debate to do justice to the topic. Number one is that there needs to be in electricity generation a balance. As so often, it was Winston Churchill that summarised it. He said, when it comes to electricity generation, the solution is variety and variety alone. In other words, you cannot rely solely on one mode of generating electricity. Each have pros and cons. You cannot put all the eggs in one basket. And as a supporter of renewables, in particular the green ports in Inverness and Tromarty Firth, the great work that is done by a number of companies who are already employing thousands of people and will employ thousands of more, and that's great for the Highlands. But is there too much emphasis now on wind energy? Do we not need to look at forms of electricity that are not stochastic, are not intermittent, like gas, for example? I think we should. And actually, gas is now part of the approved EU taxonomy. In other words, the EU say that gas is an acceptable form in terms of emissions of generating electricity. And my understanding was that the SNP wanted to follow EU regulation. So maybe the Minister could say whether that then automatically entails as a concomitant conclusion that we are now for new gas power stations. Because there needs to be backup at the time when the wind doesn't blow or the hydropower doesn't provide electricity because of seasonal issues. Every type of renewables have advantages, but they also have disadvantages. The second point I want to make is to ask the question which we should always ask ourselves, cui bono, who benefits? And I'm really concerned that there will not be enough benefit to people, for example, in Kiltarlity and Broadford, and I know that this is primarily about the North East, but you also mentioned the Highlands, who benefits? I think SSE, Scottish Power, need to do far more. Why don't they create new housing as a lasting legacy? Not just £5,000 per megawatt. That's yesterday. There needs to be a debate. I know lots of good things are being done, but not enough is being done. Saying, officer, I'm not quite sure how much time I've got left.
You've run out of your time.
I've run out. Well, can I just finish by urging the Minister, in all sincerity, let's have a three-hour debate about this topic. I can't do this justice in the time I have. I don't think anybody can. But this is hugely important to Scotland. We have to reflect, get things right, and not just rush on regardless without reflection. And above all, we must listen to the people in Scotland, wherever they're from. In life and democracy, everybody counts or nobody counts.
Thank you. There is a lot of interest in participating in this debate, as Mr Ewing has anticipated. Therefore, I think members will have to adhere to the speaking time allocations if we're to get everybody involved. I call Tim Eagle to be followed by Michael Mara. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Eagle.
Thank you very much. I'll try and nip on within my 4 minutes there, Presiding Officer. First of all, can I declare a bit of an interest? I have previously worked in this field for crofting groups, where I've advised them on tenancy rights and expected rents for a wind farm up in the Highlands. So I have got a bit of an interest there. Also, offer my apologies to Tess White and the other members in this room. I have to go, unfortunately, after I've spoken to another debate on an important rural issue here in the Parliament that just came up yesterday. So, and thank you, Presiding Officer, for giving me the pre-agreement that I could do that. But in all seriousness, that doesn't take away from the debate. And the fact that we have got so many people in here this room for a members' debate, it shows just how important this is. Yeah. And I echo the comments by Fergus Ewing. It doesn't do it justice to do this in 45 minutes. We really need to have a much, much longer debate about the issues that are going on, because that green future can only be done well if we all come together, communities, politicians and everything. Most including me recognise the climate emergency we face, the need for action and change. I want to be clear that I don't see this debate as one about climate change, or climate policy or politics. This debate is about how we reach climate goals together. This debate is about how we ensure that the beauty of Scotland, and it is beautiful, that hundreds of thousands of residents and tourists each year enjoy, is not destroyed. The trouble with politics sometimes is that in a race for the goal, we lose sight of all else that is important. In our race to secure a renewable future, I believe we are losing sight of the impact infrastructure is having now. We simply must stop to consider the how of our green future. I fully support a strong renewable energy industry, one that creates jobs, provides community support and, importantly, expands and contributes to the Scottish economy as a whole. But that sector... Yep, absolutely.
Minister.
I agree with everything that he said in this regard. Would he support me in my calls for making that consultation and engagement with public by transmission operators mandatory?
Tim Eagle.
Yeah, I think we would. But I think it has to go beyond that. I think what we need to see with engagement is true engagement. What we're seeing from the likes of SSEN at the moment is putting forward pitiful proposals. They're not fully developed. They're turning up to meetings without the full base of knowledge and everything else. So mandatory is absolutely important, but we've also got to make sure that at the Scottish Government level, when it gets to yourself, Minister, that we are absolutely listening to what the communities are saying, and that's really very important. Yesterday in the Chamber, the Minister, Gillian Martin, made comment on the need for meaningful engagement with communities when questioned by my colleague Oliver Mundell. And Oliver was trying to suggest that we should have legal support to communities during public inquiries. I would go further than that. In my previous life as a land agent, it was quite common for applicants to pay the professional fees for landlords and tenants where projects are being considered. I see no reason why that cannot be expanded to community groups. Applicants should give a fair amount of money so that they can seek professional support. At this point in time, they are on their own. I also recognise that we are seeing some negatives of this. Water supplies is one of them. We have seen some water supplies decreasing in areas where wind turbines have gone up. So I think that there needs to be more thought given to where these things do go, where these projects do take off, that there is financial support should things go wrong. At the moment, communities being left alone. Now, specifically, and this is on a point Tess White made, about the SSE and pylon work in the Highlands of Moray, in which I have received a phenomenal amount of letters and emails. This is a huge development, and many local groups are rightly concerned. My thought is that there is an alternative by subsea, and that the reason they're not doing that at the moment is cost. Yep. That should not be off the agenda. They have got to make sure that that is discussed. Presiding Officer, as politicians, we have spent years telling communities to get involved. Community planning boards, local planning, local action groups, community councils, area forums. This government's Community Empowerment Act talked at length about quality of life and engagement. Well, today, there are nearly 100 people sitting in this room, many more at home, and they are engaging. Yep. This government needs to listen, provide support where it is needed, tell SSEN to think again about their pylon plan, and work with communities to select the right locations in the right places so that we can build our sustainable future together. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Michael Mara to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Mara.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I start by thanking Tess White for securing the debate? I am the sole non-Conservative signatory on the motion, which I do not entirely agree with. But I felt it was very important that we have this debate in Parliament today. And I agree entirely. entirely with Fergus Ewing. There should be a debate on this issue in government time so we can actually explore it fully. There's much that I won't be able to say today as a result of that. I think that the failure to upgrade our energy infrastructure will jeopardise any chance that we have of achieving climate change targets that are set by both the UK and the Scottish governments, led by the SNP and the Conservatives. There is a shared mission in this regard, as Tim Eagle points out. I also have been persuaded by the case when I've engaged with many experts around this issue for overhead lines. But I do believe it's incumbent on the government to make that case, to make the case to residents who are here today and those who have not been able to join us. And I hope the Minister can do some of that today and can more broadly build the confidence of residents in that regard. In February of this year, I visited the village of Kirsten near Brechin and I met with local residents there. Many accepted that the Kintore to Teeling project will go ahead, but they were seeking the best route for that overhead line in order to have the least detrimental impact on residents, on the environment and on businesses. Residents expressed their concerns about some of the information that is used to determine the route for that overhead line, including the maps that were being used, SSEN's familiarity with the topography, the failure in their view for somebody to walk the line to understand the environment that they were intervening in. The impact on farming land was particularly acute. But there are also businesses impacted, including the local business at the cutting edge of new farming technology, a range of tourism businesses who have had representations for in the area. And as local employers, they have very significant concerns about what this project will mean for the livelihoods of many in the areas and the possibility, for potential for any compensation in that regard. Well, I am grateful to SSEN colleagues for meeting with me on numerous occasions to raise some of these issues with them, where we have had constructive discussion about the challenges and the potential solutions. And I do think there is more work that has to be done to improve those plans. SSEN have rightly pointed out that the energy policies and targets that have been established by both the UK and the Scottish governments require this infrastructure to be built. And there is politics at play in this discussion, but it has to be on the basis of how we achieve the ends that we all agree on. The company, in some respects, is caught in the middle of this. And what I believe is a failure of both governments to communicate to the public just how necessary these infrastructure improvements are. I would gently point out to Conservative colleagues in the Chamber that the need for energy infrastructure upgrades is as much a result of UK government policy as it is of Scottish government policy. Please.
Minister.
Would we not also agree that I agree about his point about communicating the need for the infrastructure, but not I also agree that there's a need for the ESO and wider society and indeed the media to communicate the need for this if we want to reach net zero and for energy security reasons?
Michael Mann.
I strongly agree with that. I don't have any chat. I think that it's incumbent on all of us to have that conversation. And again, it's why I signed this motion to try and have the conversation here today. And I would encourage the government to do its own part in that regard as well. I think there is a case to be made by both parties that have spoken already in the debate in that end. So I was pleased to see, not at the moment, if I can make some progress, I'm sorry, I'm almost run out of time. I was pleased to see SSEN's announcement yesterday that they are actively considering community and landowner proposed alignments in Kintore to Teeling project around Kirsten, Dramock and Echt. I know that SSEN are also engaging with some of the businesses that I met with in Kirsten. The planning route has to be flexible and responsive. And where I've pushed the contractor, I have found them to be so. But I recognise, speaking to some of the protesters outside, they do not share that experience. I would encourage them to get in contact with me, where possible, or other representatives, so we can push their case with SSEN and see the changes that are absolutely necessary. And as these projects are rolled out across Scotland, I've been saying to colleagues, presiding officer, this is a film coming to a cinema near you. Frankly, it's not just the North East, this is going to impact citizens right across Scotland. So the Parliament has to take rightful note of it. So I think there's a broader issue in this about community benefit. We have to see economic benefit. And by that, I mean jobs, presiding officer. We have to see the supply chain investment we need. We had a meeting this morning in Parliament organised by Michelle Thompson, MSP, talking to investors, presiding officer. And we have to make sure that those jobs accompany this, because that is what will secure the support of the public more than anything else.
Thank you. I now call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Alistair Allen. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
It's a pleasure to follow Michael Mara, it always is. But on this occasion, I'm sorry, I can't agree with the premise of his argument, because his starting point is that the overhead line is the single only possible solution. And that is clearly not the case. Now, I want to thank Tess White because she is a doughty champion for her constituents, and I'm delighted that she raised this topic in the chamber. I will give way because I mentioned Michael Mara.
I appreciate him giving way. I did not say that in my speech. What I said was I was convinced of the case with the experts that I have engaged with. I think it's the right case, but I think it is incumbent on governments, both governments, to make their case as to why this is the solution that's being pursued.
Stephen Kerr.
But what I thought I understood you to say was, the member to say, was the overhead line was the single solution, and the case that needed to be made was for upgrading the grid. No one is arguing about the need for us to invest in the grid. What we're talking about here is this issue and how it impacts the communities of the northeast of Scotland. So Scottish ministers... I will, yes.
Finlay Carson.
I really appreciate you giving away, given the constraints in time. Can I just say, this is a national problem. I could fill the gallery with constituents from Dumfries and Galloway representing Hands Off Our Hills, Scotland Against Spin, Galloway Against Pylons. We have exactly the same situation where Scottish Power have defaulted to look at the lowest cost consented route. And they don't understand that overhead lines will not be consented because the communities don't want that. And there's a reluctance to look at undergrounding. And that's something that should be one of the first options, not one of the last options.
Stephen Kerr.
To Finlay Carson for his intervention. Ministers need to be aware and beware that about the strength of feeling there is in the communities of the northeast of Scotland about this issue. And there shouldn't be an attempt to try and confuse this matter in the minds of the public, because the public well understand that it is the Scottish ministers, the SNP government, who are the ultimate planning authority on this matter. I won't be able to give way. I wish I could. It's the case for a longer debate that was well made by Fergus Ewing. We've seen how effectively the SNP can use the planning system to stop stuff that they don't like. For example, nuclear power, another mistake. And there's no point in the SNP, as they're trying to do, I think, in hiding from this issue. And when SSEN say they can't underground or offshore the lines, and they try to give spurious technical excuses for not giving alternative solutions active consideration, I'm afraid it just doesn't wash. I can see Michael Mara gesticulating, but it just doesn't wash, because we know that undergrounding or offshoring is feasible. Look what's happening in Germany. Look what is happening in Germany to protect their natural environment from mega pylons and overhead lines. They're building a 200-mile-long underground cable route, ANORD it's called, that will transport renewable energy from the north to the south of Germany. So it can be done. And I don't really know anyone in the community action groups, many of whom, as we've said, are here today, who are opposed to clean energy or renewables. We may not all share the enthusiasm of some for the vast wind farms that we now see crowding our landscapes, but we all recognise the need to decarbonise and renew the grid. But the current plan industrialises rural Scotland with mega metal structures and power lines. And we have before us an infrastructure project that's going to stand for between 50 and 100 years. So with an eye on that kind of timescale, why are we rushing ahead with the lowest cost, most intrusive solution because of some artificially imposed deadline? I would love to be able to give way, but I can't. I can understand why anyone would think about sacrificing our country's natural beauty and the well-being of our communities. Scotland is renowned for its magnificence. People come from all over the world to visit the most beautiful country in the world. They spend hundreds of millions of pounds. Are we really prepared to blight our tourist sector? And as MSPs, we should be empowering, not undermining, Scotland's natural beauty. And I wholeheartedly support the aims of the Angus Pylon Action Group and the Stop Tealing Industrialisation Group and commend them for their campaign. I fear for communities. Places like Jericho and Douglastown, just next to where my grandparents, Charles and Maggie Kerr, farmed as tenants. I'm not speaking against what needs to be done to address the issues of clean energy and energy security, but I am not willing to stand back and see communities and landscapes sacrificed when other options exist but are not properly being addressed.
Thank you. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Up to 4 minutes, Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to begin by thanking Tess White for securing this debate today. Whether or not we always realise that energy infrastructure affects every single one of us, but rural constituencies like my own probably do realise it more than most. To achieve net zero emission targets of both the UK and Scottish Government by 2050 and 2045 respectively, The Independent Climate Change Committee has forecast that a doubling of electricity supply will be required to meet demand. Naturally, this requires very extensive improvements to and expansion of our existing electricity infrastructure. Now, of course, the Scottish Government, as others have accurately pointed out, faces limitations in reforming energy policy as it is a matter reserved to the UK Government. And to give an example of that, outdated transmission charges result in higher electricity costs for Northern Scotland residents, despite renewable energy sources being based there. And the UK Government's wider lack of adequate regulation leads to wider problems for rural and island areas. For instance, a constituent of mine was recently told by Octopus Energy that they hadn't encountered the island's postcode before, and so fitting a new meter could take several years. But to return to the matter being debated today, I do believe that there needs to be a greater understanding of just how critical existing and planned infrastructure's updates are to ensuring the safe and reliable transmission of electricity across Scotland. And I want to focus on one particular project, which I do understand has provoked debate along its route, and perhaps to offer a different, more westerly perspective on it. Electricity for the whole of my constituency, the Western Isles, is currently supplied by two subsea cables from the north of Skye. Significant sections of the electricity line between Fort Augustus and Skye, which supplies that, were built over 70 years ago. These sections are fast approaching the end of their operational life, as demonstrated by three major faults suffered on this line during the last year. The total failure of the cable between Skye and Harris recently resulted in 20,000 people in Lewis and Harris having to rely on a 70-year-old diesel-fired power station in Stornoway for several months. That was obviously far from ideal from an emissions perspective and has caused some anxiety about future sustainability. And the existing overhead line, therefore, between Fort Augustus and Skye, I should point out, is a single circuit with no backup transmission circuits in the event of a fault. So I do have to register, therefore, the view of many island constituents that a double circuit replacement there would greatly strengthen network resilience and reliability. The point made, and made very well, is that community input is absolutely essential for infrastructure projects like overhead lines. Listening to and addressing local concerns should be prioritised, not treated as an afterthought or as a tick-box exercise. When people work well together, important improvements can be made to proposals, and as a direct result, I understand, of stakeholder feedback, for example, SSEN are, I hope, now planning on undergrounding some sections of the Fort Augustus to Skye line in the area around the iconic Coolin mountain ranges. But as we move towards our net zero aims, I do believe that we must look to do what is right for Scotland's future generations. Communities must be listened to, and we must upgrade and expand our energy infrastructure so that it's fit for the years ahead. These two aims, Presiding Officer, need not be, and indeed should not be, in opposition to one another.
Thank you, Dr Allen. Before calling the next speaker, I'm conscious of the number of speakers that still want to contribute to the debate, so I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I invite Tess White to move such a motion.
I move the motion, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Are we all agreed to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes? We are all agreed. On that basis, I can call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Mark Ruskell, up to 4 minutes. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating my colleague Tess White in securing this vitally important debate today and pay tribute to Tess, who, like my colleague Stephen Kerr, have raised this issue time and time again in this chamber. And obviously a big thanks to all the campaigners who have made their way down to Parliament today to have their voices heard in, for such a vital issue. Presiding Officer, we often hear calls from this government for a just transition for the North East. But what we have going on with the electricity infrastructure plans is an unjust transition. Would it be just if we saw the mass industrialisation of the North East of Scotland in the pursuit of net zero? I don't think so, but that is exactly what is happening right now. Local communities such as Turriff and New Deer are angry at the lack of understanding from this central belt-focused government. They feel ignored, sidelined, shut out by a distant Holyrood, completely unaware of the needs of rural Scotland, hell-bent on destroying vital natural environments that are key to the economic future of the North East. Presiding officer, there's nothing short of vandalism being done to rural communities throughout the North East. Last week, I asked Minister Julian Martin to ensure the devolved government used the planning powers they have to ensure that the overdevelopment of these areas are stopped. The answer then was nothing short of a disgrace. Passing the buck and saying the Scottish Government have no powers to instruct the transmission operators to opt for underground cabling. Well, Minister, you have...
give you examples.
I will take that Minister. Intervention.
So, I am actually stating a fact when I say that. Legislation and regulations relating to energy and gas networks are reserved to the UK Government. Therefore, you can't mandate any kind of engineering overgrounding or undergrounding. But that could be done. That could be done by the UK Government. So will he write to the UK Government and make that point?
Douglas Lumsden.
I thank the Minister for that intervention. You're right, you can't dictate to them what they must do. But you can dictate to them...
Through the chair, Mr. Lumsden.
But you can't dictate to them what they can't do. You know, as we've heard already, you've got planning powers to stop nuclear power stations, for example. You use the powers then. You could use that powers in the exact same way to stop what we're seeing right across the northeast of Scotland. Because, presiding officer, we are elected here to represent and speak up for our constituents. And judging by the hundreds of emails I have had on this subject and the demonstration that we had outside today, that is exactly what I am doing. SNP MSPs are failing in their duties to represent the needs of our hard-working constituents. Julian Martin is meant to be here to represent communities. Instead, she's ignoring them, ignoring their pleas, ignoring their emails I was hearing earlier, ignoring their calls and ignoring their protest at what is being done to them. We have seen and experienced the abject failure of the SNP government in listening to the needs of our rural communities. It is a litany of failures that sees no end in sight, no matter who they choose to lead them or who they partner with. This party is so focused on independence that they have lost the ability to listen to our communities that I am proud to serve. Presiding officer, I am fully behind our move towards net zero, and it cannot be at any cost. The decisions we make now will be with us for the next 50 to 100 years. Let's do it right. We cannot allow the desecration of the northeast of Scotland to take place. We must work with our communities and not against them. I think we all agree something needs to be done, but it needs to be done right. Is that an intervention from Michael Mara there? No? This vandalism of our natural environment must stop. This focus on the needs of the Central Belt must stop. This deliberate rush to destroy our beautiful countryside with unwanted and unnecessary pylons must stop. I am proud to support this motion today. And more importantly, presiding officer, I stand with and support my constituents who have travelled here today, and I fully support them. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call Mark Ruskell to be followed by Alexander Burnett. Up to 4 minutes,
thank
Mr.
Thank you, presiding officer. And can I thank Tess White for bringing forward this important debate. But of course, this isn't a new debate, and there are many lessons from history. After the Second World War, Tom Johnston brought hydropower to the Glens for the first time, and of course it led to dramatic economic progress and improved quality of life for so many communities. But it would be wrong to assume that that progress came with no cost. Some communities were abandoned, pristine rivers were damaged, and some, like the River Garry, are only starting to make a recovery today. So there will always be a balance to be struck between national energy needs, local and global environmental impacts, and the need for communities to have a stake in both decision-making and the economic rewards of projects. Now, in more recent times, the Beaulieu-Denny powerline upgrade, consented, I believe, by Mr. Ewing, has left us with many lessons, and the debates from 18 years ago are now being, of course, rerun all over again with the SSEN programme. So let me just reflect on some of those debates that I was involved with at that time. Firstly, there were arguments that no grid upgrades were needed, that wind farms would never be built. But we have to accept the reality today that Beaulieu-Denny was needed, that it did lead to onshore wind farms being constructed, and that those wind farms have slashed the climate impact of electricity while benefiting communities across the UK through lower electricity generation costs. And Lord Callanan, the Conservative UK Energy Minister, is absolutely right when he says that we need to build four times as much infrastructure by 2030 than was built in the last 30 years. And the missed 2030 target reminds us for climate, reminds us that there is no path to net zero in Scotland or the UK without a massive switch from fossil fuels to electricity for both transport and heating. The reality is that the bulk of that can only come from renewable energy, and it will need the new transmission lines to get it to where it was needed. If there's time in hand, I will give way to Mr. Carson.
Finlay Carson.
Very briefly, taking into account everything you're saying, would you agree that the current planning system is completely broken, with local authorities' planning departments not having the capacity to deal with the applications, and when they do, in Dumfries and Galloway, 8 out of 12 applications that were objected to by the local communities and local authorities were overturned by the Energy Consent Unit
Mark
in the Scottish Parliament?
Mark Gruskell.
Well, again, I don't have time, and I think a three-hour debate would be fantastic on this. There is certainly lessons to be learned from Bewley Denny about early engagement with developers. And in this case, of course, it goes through a different consenting process to the ones that local authorities are engaged with. But the critical point here is about early engagement. And I'll come on to more points about that later on if I have time. Now, secondly, reflecting on Bewley Denny, there were those who acknowledged the national need for grid upgrades but believed that undergrounding was a panacea, out of sight, out of mind, shove it all underground. Now, I wish that that was the case, because undoubtedly there's going to be a landscape impact from new pylon lines. They're not pretty. But digging a motorway-sized trench through sensitive landscapes and farmland across rivers and streams does cause environmental damage, and it does lead to vulnerability of supply, and it does require vastly more expensive infrastructure. That's just a reality. Thirdly, with Bewley Denny, there were those communities who accepted the need for pylon upgrades, who reluctantly accepted that complete undergrounding may not be feasible, but successfully negotiated changes with developers at that time. And they not only won route alterations, they also managed to secure other improvements, including the removal of existing infrastructure, such as substations. Now, I'm pleased that there appears to be some progress in these types of negotiations with the current SSEN programme, just as there was with Bewley Denny, but it's clear that the developers need to go further. They need to double down on their work with communities and find compromises that are not going to be welcomed by everybody, but will become more acceptable. Starting off, so my final point is about mitigation. The long, drawn-out and bitter public inquiry over Bewley Denny led to years of wrangling before a programme could be agreed and delivered. We can't afford another four-year public inquiry process with the SSEN programme. These projects have to be delivered faster if we're to make progress. But communities also can't wait for funding for landscape mitigation to come years after the event. The developers need to be designing those options now with communities alongside the route selection process. Signing off, so these grid upgrades must happen. They cannot be delayed. It is inevitable there will be some landscape impact. But developers need to work harder with communities, minimise the
impact, you need to conclude?
And invest in the future.
Thank you. I now call Alexander Burnett to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Burnett.
Thank you. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And as many of my points have been covered, I'll try and be brief, but start by thanking Tess White for securing this debate. I'd also welcome to the Chamber today people from the North East, including constituents of mine who are part of Deeside Against Pylons. Just some of many who have travelled down to protest against the Scottish Government's destruction of our countryside. Over the last year, I have repeatedly highlighted the impact of the SNP's government's unjust transition and how it will affect our rural communities. I spoke just a month ago about the hundreds of wind turbines currently in the planning process, and note my register of interest of two 12-kilowatt farm turbines built a decade ago, 45,000 times smaller than those planned in McCabrick, an area impacted by this government's plans to install 3,400 turbines between 2022 and 2030. Now, the Beyond 2030 report proposes 9 new major overhead lines across rural Scotland, in addition to
to the current pylon proposals that rural communities are currently fighting against. So alternative options must be seriously considered, such as undergrounding and subsea cabling, which an Ofgem briefing just this morning states is the most appropriate for transmission over long distances. So decisions need to consider the environmental impact on our countryside, and more importantly, those who live there and will be directly affected. I've urged the Scottish Government and the Energy Minister, Gillian Martin, whose own constituency will be affected, to listen to the calls from local communities and her own constituents to have a statutory voice in the planning process, as happens elsewhere in the UK. Because as it stands, communities aren't being made aware of these developments at an early enough stage to influence these proposals. Consultation events are nothing more than a tick box exercise for developers and used to pit communities against each other. My inbox is inundated with constituents telling me their concerns are repeatedly ignored by developers, requests for meetings rejected, and events held during the working day when most people are unable to attend. I'll give way to Mark
Ruskell. Mark Ruskell.
For giving way, does he not recognise, though, that the lessons here from Bewley Denny, that the inevitability is that these pylon lines are going to be constructed, and that now is the time for the developers to be working with communities on landscape mitigation, on route selection, on making sure that these projects are developed in the best way that they can be? It's not about communities being pitted against each other. It is about having a process that actually gets to an outcome that delivers on climate and delivers what electricity consumers across the UK need, and what his own government minister wants to see at UK.
Alexander Burnett.
I'm afraid I disagree with that, with Mark Ruskell there. I fundamentally disagree that these pylons are the only solution. And I think the whole purpose of a debate today, and I think it would be beneficial from a wider debate, would be actually to see what other options are available, not just for transmission, but also for the production of energy. And we need to have, as Fergus Ewing said, a varied sources of electricity. Because rural life is under threat, and I've heard from hundreds of constituents whose homes and livelihoods are at risk. There are currently over 1,400 community objections to the Hill of Fair wind farm development, and I've lost count of how many objections I've received even in the last 48 hours in objecting to the pylons. But under the current process, their voice could be ignored. And it's not clear what involvement local authorities have, as people are told they cannot lobby their councillors on these applications. Homes cannot be sold, farmland will be lost, historic sites and battlefields will be torn up, and tourism will fall. Whilst the decisions are taken by Scottish ministers and the Energy Consents Unit, who do not have to suffer the consequences of their work. So will the minister give communities a statutory voice in the planning process? I'm just closing, and the minister will have an opportunity to respond when she closes. But can I ask the minister, for when she does respond, will she give communities a statutory voice in the planning process, as occurs in England? Will the minister review her onshore wind targets, which are causing this destruction of our countryside? And finally, will the minister meet with those community groups as she is meeting with developers? Because the SNP must listen to those who have come to Edinburgh today and give communities a statutory voice.
Thank you. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Liam Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, Ms Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And thank you to Tess White for bringing this motion forward for debate. We all understand the need to transition to greener and sustainable fuel options. And put simply, electricity demand is set to double by 2050, and we must act now to deliver sustainable energy for our communities. The Scotland leasing round has exceeded expectations, almost tripling from an initial 10 gigawatt projection to the present 28 gigawatt. And the UK government has also massively increased its offshore wind ambitions to stretch its overall targets to 50 gigawatts. Now, fundamental to that is our transmission network. However, it is resoundingly clear that grid poses one of the biggest barriers to the deployment of our renewable energy pipeline. And it's important to understand electricity network legislation and regulations is reserved to the UK government, with the electricity system operator responsible for electricity planning across Great Britain and closely regulated by Ofgem.
The Pathway to 2030 project sets out the plan for new grid investment connecting new energy to homes and businesses across the UK. The commitment made by SSEN Transmission to invest over £20 billion this decade for critical grid upgrades is hugely significant for Scotland's economy, energy security and reducing energy bills for everyone. But it is absolutely imperative that significant infrastructure development derives from both industry and community needs, where communities have the opportunity to engage in the process so that areas are developed in a consensual way. I will.
Tess White.
Thank you, Audrey Nicholl, for taking the intervention, and thank you also for speaking into today's debate. One of the things that really concerned both me and my constituents was, without Michael Marra's support, this debate would have not happened today and this subject would not have been aired. So why did her and her colleagues not support this motion to have this debate? Thank you.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member for her intervention, and I note during the debate there has been a suggestion that this matter comes forward for a wider debate, and I'd be fully supportive of that. So in my own constituency, strategic infrastructure projects in the form of an energy from waste plant, a new harbour, and potentially an industrialised former green space, all within line of sight of the Balnagask area of Torry, have left residents feeling disconnected and disenfranchised. So getting the balance right is absolutely essential. And I am pleased that SSE Transmission have just this week committed to consider proposed alignments to the Kintore T-Link project, with consultations for proposed substations at Emmock and Hurley that will take place next month as planned. And like other North East MSP colleagues, I do have regular open and positive engagement with SSE on a range of energy issues. But, Presiding Officer, there is a pressing need for pace in developing these projects from desktop ambitions to project delivery. And while some goals are still years away, the scale and upskilling required needs action now. Delays in consenting risks pushing back some of these ambitious projects by years, risking jobs and vital investment. But we must strike a balance between the voice of communities and the planning process. And on this, I would welcome additional guidance from the Chief Planning Officer on NPF4 policies around transmission infrastructure. And I also support wider reform of the current Section 37 process to streamline consenting for critical infrastructure. Fixing a clear period for consenting is required, delivered by both UK and Scottish governments, working together to address existing legislative challenges whilst protecting democratic rights at a local level. So to conclude, as Mark Ruskell noted, Lord Callanan, Minister for Energy Efficiency and Green Finance, said, and I quote, "We need to build about four times as much transmission infrastructure by 2030 as we have built in the previous 20 years. I agree.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. We now move to the final speaker in the open debate, Liam Kerr, up to 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've listened very carefully to the powerful contributions from across the chamber this afternoon, and I align myself with most of them. I want to focus my remarks on the wider issues underlying the situation, because Fergus Ewing is absolutely right. This is bigger, and this should be given government time. Because what these people are facing is a function entirely of this government's utterly negligent and incomprehensible failure to come up with a holistic energy plan. It's all well and good to proudly trumpet that they want to get to net zero by 2045, but surely any responsible government would do more. No, with respect, you can answer me in your closing, Gillian Martin. Would do more than virtue signal and instead work out how to get there in terms of energy generation. Audrey Nicholl is wrong. This is not about every other agency bar this government. In fact, a responsible government would produce a holistic energy strategy, recognising we need a balanced energy mix, incorporating upskilling of jobs and a meaningful supply chain. Instead, we've got the usual piecemeal silo thinking, epitomised by a draft energy strategy, which is years late and remains unsettled. and does little more than signal to the North Sea a damaging presumption against oil and gas. We've got a government which, in the face of all the evidence suggesting its preconceptions are wrong, states it will refuse to give planning for any new nuclear in Scotland. When Torness closes, which will happen perhaps as soon as 2030, there will be no nuclear generation in Scotland's energy mix. And it's a government that crows that it has licensed the generation of around 28 gigawatts of electricity from offshore wind in the north of Scotland. This government reckons it can power the UK on wind generated in the north. But gives cursory thought as to how you transport it round Scotland and to markets throughout the UK. And it's precisely that lack of thought, that abject failure to pre-plan how you move that electricity around, that ends up in this debate today. Presiding officer, it stands to reason if you have a proper energy mix with energy stored in a different form, oil and gas, for example, or generated from where it's historically been generated, like Torness or Hunterston in the central Scotland, you may not need enormous pylons carving up the countryside of the northeast. It is not the fait accompli that Mark Ruskell seems to think that people just need to get used to. Exactly. Presiding officer, the second issue also relates to the lack of a plan. Absent such, there is no coherent, holistic consideration of how we might use the power generated at a basic level. If you generate 28 gigawatts of offshore wind, power must be got into the grid and taken to market, or presumably large constraint payments must be made to turn the turbines off if they generate too much. Transporting electricity in this volume drastically increases the magnitude of infrastructure required. More pylons, more transmission lines, more substations. And leaving aside Stephen Kerr's passionate and sage analysis of alternative methods, surely one of the solutions which should at least have been considered and strategised is electrolysing the power into green hydrogen as a battery, or for use if the market's there, but which also allows it to be transported in a different way, perhaps through the currently existing gas network. Now, I accept I am simplifying, but I cannot understand why on earth this government is not taking that holistic approach and getting to solutions in advance in carefully structured, meaningful strategies around location, source, and just how best to transport and use what is generated. Presiding officer, this government's virtue signalling, silo thinking and inability to do proper strategising and planning has led directly to the situation we find ourselves in today. And, presiding officer, that tells us all we need to know about how much this government cares about performative posturing and how little it cares for the people and countryside of the North East.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now invite Gillian Martin to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. I want to say, first of all, here's my offer. Everybody who has called for changes to the regulation of electricity infrastructure, market reforms that allow communities to have a stronger say in the infrastructure, how it's engineered in a way that's appropriate to the geography, and mandate further community engagement and hold developers to account on how they engage. Everybody who's made those points today, will you join with me in making that happen and going to the people that can make that happen? Because the people that can make that happen are the UK government, who set the regulations. Okay? I have been calling on the UK government to make reforms that would help the people that are in the gallery today. That would help them. So, and I think it's very important that we don't manage people's expectations by or look at their expectations and push them into the wrong place where they can actually make meaningful change by contacting the right people here. Legislation and regulations relating to electricity networks is reserved to Westminster, and any changes to those regulations are at UK level, and that includes direction of what engineering solutions are appropriate. The UK could change this in regulation. I will in a second. The ESO is responsible for the strategic approach to transmission investment, again, a UK body. But first of all, I wanted to say that. I wanted to make that offer to everyone, that we work together to make sure that communities have more meaningful and mandated engagement and guidelines along that.
But first of all, before I did take Tess White, I haven't started this debate in the way that I would customarily do, and actually thank Tess White for opening this discussion here. There will be plenty of opportunity for us to debate this when I bring forward the energy strategy, but I do take on board that there is a need for a wider debate to have a look at transmission infrastructure and the effect that it's having on communities and how we must be flexible in that approach. Tess White.
Tess White.
Thank you, Minister, for taking that intervention. And the Minister talks about and asks the question about mandatory consultation. That's an important point. Does she agree with me that the quality of that consultation is extremely important? And will she support the Save Our Men's petition on this point about consultation? Thank you.
Minister.
So, Tess White, I actually agree with her that when I've been hearing stories from a lot of you today, but also from the people that do email me, and I can't respond in relation to particular potential applications. And people need to understand that I would be breaking the ministerial code and putting everything in jeopardy legally if I did that. But I do listen and I do take on board that many, many people are not satisfied with how they have been engaged with. A point to Alexander Burnett's point is one that I've often made to developers in general. They must tailor their engagement in a way that they don't exclude anyone. Mr. Burnett mentioned having public meetings at a time where nobody is able to go. That's ridiculous. That's not meaningful engagement. When applications apply on my desk for determination, and you're right, at the end of a very rigorous process, they arrive on my desk for determination. It's at the end of a very rigorous process, and I take that responsibility extremely seriously. But within that application, before that application, I cannot tell developers how or where they site infrastructure. I cannot hold any position on what engineering methods they use to transmit power. Instead, I must judge the plans and the rationale put forward and make a decision based on what they have submitted. I cannot make any, and I mean any, comment, either in public or private, on the merits or otherwise of a developer. But what I can do is certainly say what I want to see to those intending to make those applications. I expect applicants to have made every effort to reach out to communities affected. They must put forward rigorous environmental impact assessments where necessary. They must put forward a comprehensive and evidence case for their development and the decisions they're making about how they conduct that development, where they put that development and why. I also very much expect that they explain the rationale for their plans, and I would like to see in every application where there has been community campaigns against them, as there have been in so many things that have been mentioned today, which I can't speak to directly, that they have taken on board and worked with those communities and been flexible about their concerns. Yes.
Finlay Carson.
I really appreciate the Minister giving way, but despite all the engagement that's promised, is the thing we need to address the intransigent of these power companies actually to change their mind? You can consult to as long as the day. The day is long, but if they're not in a position to change their mind, it's completely not utterly pointless. And then transigence is why we're seeing a lot of conflict in communities.
Minister.
I agree with the member. It has to be meaningful engagement. I was quoted earlier on by one of your colleagues saying that. And that's why if we had guidance and a mandated engagement with guidance as to what is appropriate and how that should be done, then communities can hold them to account. That's what I would like to see. That would help us greatly. That would help us all greatly. Because at the moment, when I hear stories where there's developers that have not been engaging, I think they're not doing themselves any favours whatsoever. This costs them money. It costs them money. It puts them back years. They need to engage early, and it has to be meaningful, and they have to demonstrate an ability to look at their plans again and make adjustments that will bring a community with them. I also want to say extreme weather events have seen homes and businesses without power, and not least in the North East, and many households in my constituency across the North East lost power for over a week during Storm Arwen. And I think that we all agree that there is an upgrade that is needed to the existing transmission infrastructure as well. I would just say, yes, I will.
Douglas Lobston.
Just on the point of extreme weather, do you not think that's actually a case to have more undergrounding of cables? Or do you believe, like
the chair, Mr. Lumsden,
Mark Ruskell, that it's a fait accompli, that you know, these pylons are going to go up regardless of what happens from any consultation, and it's really just the communities have to get used to it, because I think that's an appalling attitude that we've heard earlier on.
Minister.
Mr Lumsden, I have already said I cannot comment on the merits or otherwise of any engineering solutions. I must look at what's put in front of me. But these developers have a responsibility to work with communities and explain or indeed adapt their plans in terms of what engineering solutions they're going to provide. We've already heard that there are, in particular areas, there has been flexibility there. Long may that continue. That's the only way they're going to bring communities with them. There will be impacts on communities that host this infrastructure. Communities and statutory bodies must have the opportunity to engage in the process as early as possible. Now, I hosted a round table, and we'll be brief, presiding officer, with fuel poverty campaigners yesterday, along with Ofgem. Inequity was a strong theme. Higher fuel costs in rural areas contributes towards higher levels of fuel poverty. This is an inequity, and I agree very much with my friend and colleague Fergus Ewing, cui bono. Who benefits from this? If we are hosting this infrastructure, our communities must see the benefit for this, and I will take a brief intervention if the presiding officer
very allows. Briefly, Fergus Ewing.
Will the Minister have discussions with SSC and Scottish Power to get them to increase the amount of benefit that the people of Scotland get?
Minister.
There has been some movement from the UK Government, indeed, on the benefit, mandating benefit for transmission operators. I would go four square behind that being increased, absolutely. But I don't think it's just about community benefit. I think it's about the reform of the energy markets as a whole, to make sure that those areas of the country that are hosting infrastructure, that are producing a lot of the power, see the benefit directly. I think that would change minds a great deal, because at the moment, Fergus Ewing is absolutely right. We have repeatedly called on the UK government to decouple the cost of gas from the price of electricity paid by consumers. Urgent market reforms are needed to support long-term energy affordability and insulate bill payers, particularly those at the risk of fuel poverty. Any market reforms that this UK government or the next implements must right this wrong. I just want to finish, though, by saying thanks to Tess White for bringing this forward. It's allowed us to air, to a certain extent, some of the concerns and some of our expectations that we have of developers. I stand behind communities. They must have a say, and they must never feel that they're not being listened to. This is a process in which we have to work together, UK Government, Scottish Government, regulators and developers and communities together, in order to reach net zero and provide energy security for everyone.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.